So I am very passionate about donuts because Andrew mentioned in my intro that I had a lifelong love of donuts. For those that did go to the Heights, if anyone here, I think I saw a hand, we had 30 minutes every day during study hall where if you were a senior, you could go off campus for 30 minutes and get like a snack. And so we would go every day to the local Dunkin' Donuts and we would each buy and completely finish a six-pack of donuts. So I don't know how I'm not diabetic. And also I'm not 500 pounds, but I love donuts, right? And I get excited and that excitement I hope translates of like the I so kind of to take that kind of passion question and think about, okay, how do you get off the ground, right? I think number one, if you are working a different job, kind of to pay the bills, make ends meet, and you're now thinking about, okay, I want to start a company. You can't do it. You can't just quit your job with like having no customers, no ideas, no partners. You kind of have to work that up. So you have to do what's called the nights and weekends routine. So literally, and it was funny, I'll kind of talk about baby scripts, but I think this also applies for District Donut. I was consulting at Deloitte. Actually, on baby scripts, my business partner was a fellow person I worked with at Deloitte. And so what we would do is we would wait for the last person on our team to leave the office. And so it was like 6:30, 7, maybe a later day, 7:30, and we'd be working, working, working. The second that they leave and close the door, we would immediately come together and do the business plan for baby scripts. And then we would do that on the weekends. And people would come in the weekends and be like, "Damn, Anish and Juan Pablo, you guys are working your asses off," you know? And so, you know, I think that's, you know, cursed at the the Maloney Hall, my bad. But but when you think about the dynamic, it was cool, it was fun, and yeah, you just have to make it work because you just don't have the opportunity of like, I don't know, paying rent and also kind of coming up with the business plan while not getting any money in return. So yeah, that's how we started when we got off the ground. And I'm also really torn. I mean, my philosophy around entrepreneurship, and this conflicts with the books. So, I don't know if you can put this in that, blue book. Do you guys still use blue books, by the way? Oh, yes. Okay. So yeah, I graduated 2010. I still got this. All right. But in the when you're doing the essays, again, people look at the books say, okay, you really have to address a market. You really have to find the problem. You have to scope it out. You have to really, when you talk to a lot of investors, the first thing they'll ask you is not what does your product do? They'll say, what's the problem? And so I do think there's a piece there that you have to 100% look at. But I believe that a lot of the most transformational, whether it's technologies or brands, are because of the vision that the founders have. Look at Elon Musk. Like, yeah, you could say that like electric vehicles are incredibly important. But like, there are all kinds of questions around electric vehicles. There are all kinds of questions around the size, the market cap of his business, whether he deserves to be a $100 billion company when he has like a tenth or less of the sales of General Motors that or Ford that's a $30 billion company. But why is it valued so much? It's valued because the vision that Elon has. And I think a lot of entrepreneurship, you're pitching yourself, you're pitching the problem and the solution that you have. But you're also in there and you have to make people believe. And I'll never forget, when we started, and this is more baby scripts, not District Donut, but when we were pitching VCs, I'd go to Silicon Valley and they'd be like, "All right, like, let's see the pitch deck." I'd do the hour-long pitch, and then the partners would dissect everything. They'd be like, "Oh, you sell to doctors? That's a terrible business model. That's never gonna work." And so you kind of get beat down and you're like, well, maybe we have to change our approach. Maybe we have to like be different. We have to go into a different vertical in healthcare. We have to try something. Product needs to look different. Maybe not babies. Let's do old people or something, whatever. And so you kind of have this moment of a shock or this crisis of confidence. But one of my friends who's also a venture capitalist said, and this was one of the best pieces of advice that I ever had, is if you truly believe in your product, if you truly believe that your approach is transformational, it's logical, it actually makes sense. What you're trying to do makes sense to you, and hopefully you're not insane. But if you're not insane, and this truly is something that can change the game, whether it's donuts or it's pregnancy software to make less moms die while they're pregnant, fight back. A venture capitalist says, "Oh, selling to the doctor is the worst idea possible." You go, "You know what? I call BS on that. And let me tell you why. And you're wrong. And no one will know your business. No one will know your business more than you. So you have all the ammunition to push back. And don't let people push you over when you're raising money, when you're telling your story. Some people might look at their phone, look at them and be like, why are you looking at your phone? I'm pitching you. I just traveled 5,000 miles to be with you and you're looking on your phone? I literally stop pitches when partners do that. And I just wait. I go, oh, email's done? Okay, let's keep the presentation going. And so I might get a little animated, but you do have to be a little pissed off and you do have to create moments of friction because the status quo, the way things work right now, is there's something called inertia. You guys are familiar with that term, right? Everything is set up in the market right now so that you don't succeed. Everything is set up so that nothing changes. Everyone's making money right now, right? Procter & Gamble, Dunkin' Donuts, Krispy Kreme, GE, Philips, they're making tons of money. And so why would they want anything to change, right? People that are doing their jobs, they know what to do. They know expectations. They know how to get evaluated. Why would they want to change? So it's up to you to convince people and to really push back and be like, this is the change that this space needs. Do you want moms to die? Or more trivial, do you want a shitty donut, right? So these are the moments that, and no one's going to fight for you. Absolutely no one is going to fight for you. You've got to take that, whether is someone going to come out from the stands and jump on the basketball court and all of a sudden like start playing for your team? Absolutely not. It's you and your team. It's you up against, I don't know who you guys play. Like, I don't know who the rival is, but, Notre Dame, it was Michigan. Hate Michigan. So, no one is going to fight that fight for you. And I think that's the first kind of realization. And if you don't get pissed off, if you don't get direct, if it isn't personal, then guess what? You're not trying hard enough. And if you're not trying hard enough, you will fail. You will absolutely fail. So if one thing that you guys take from this is that you gotta work your ass off to be an entrepreneur and you gotta fight for your beliefs, whether it's in business or in life, then I think that's what it takes to be successful. So I'll finish this the monologue, but I think that's important.